Hey gang, thanks for tuning in. Got a quick lesson here for you. Today is about developing relationships, how to make friends and develop relationships, because man, it's so important to do that at school. And to begin with, I want to share a little story with you about making friends. This comes from me being a pastor here at a large church. Every once in a while, somebody will say, you know, I can't make friends at this church. You guys are an unfriendly church, which is always odd to me because I'm like, most people around here have zillions of friends. And so I always like to tell them the saga of Victor and Jill. I'm going to tell you that right now. Victor and Jill showed up at our church one time. They'd been part of the church for maybe about a month. And I was at a leadership meeting when we were discussing that we had a need for some volunteers to help out with a certain ministry. And somebody said, oh, I know, we should ask Victor and Jill to help out. And everybody around the leadership table said, yeah, we love Victor and Jill. Ask those guys. And I looked around and I said, you know, this is fascinating, guys. Victor and Jill have only been part of our church for 1 month, and yet everybody at this table knows who they are. How can that be? And you know what we discovered? Victor and Jill had always signed up for everything that we needed a volunteer for, to drive the junior high van. Even on Sunday mornings when they weren't signed up for cleanup, you'd see them with the broom, and they got involved. They signed up for everything, and in doing so, they managed to meet a whole bunch of people. And I'll tell you this, they were only with us for 1 year. Victor worked for FedEx, and he actually told me, he said, well, Dain, when we go to a new town, we find a church, and then we decide this is the church we're going to serve. At the end of 1 year with us, we had a farewell party for them with about 150 people showed up. Join an organization, serve in an organization. It's a great way to make friends. And by the way, one small caveat about that, if you're like, yeah, I'm going to join a fraternity or a sorority, maybe don't pick the most popular fraternity or sorority. You know, sometimes they're hard to get into, and they're a bunch of people that really want to sort of, they're there for themselves. What I would encourage you instead is find an organization on campus where their point is to either work for a higher purpose, you know, save the world, save the whales. I'm exaggerating, but you get my point. Or they exist to serve the community. People that are involved in something bigger than themselves. It's a great place to meet wonderful people that will actually show an interest in your life. And speaking of, when you meet people, practice what I call verbal judo. Now, Dale Carnegie, in his famous book series, How to Win Friends and Influence People, he says this is one of the most important things you can do when you meet people, and that is this: get them to talk about themselves. And what I mean by verbal judo is if they say, where are you from? And you say, well, I'm from Hawaii. And everybody's like, wow, Hawaii. Quickly turn it around and say, where are you from? If they're like, oh, I'm from nowhere in Nebraska. I grew up on a farm. What you do is you say, a farm in Nebraska? That's amazing. I've never even been on a farm. I've never been to Nebraska. What's it like in Nebraska? You see what I did there? As soon as they ask you a question about you, you spin it to ask them about them. Do this for like 2 straight weeks. Always get people to talk about what is everybody's favorite subject, themselves. After you know everything about them, they will actually want to hear about you and your life. And by the way, if they don't, this is kind of one caveat at the end. If you invest your life into somebody and at the end of a couple of weeks, they don't care about where you're from or what you're about, yeah, you might want to lose them as a friend. There's people like that, particularly if they're of the opposite sex and they don't show any interest whatsoever in your life. Yeah, find somebody else to be your friend. And then when you do find that person, you know, you've done this great conversation with them, they're interested in you, you're interested in them, you've got to contact them. You can't sit around waiting for those people to call you or text you or whatever you guys do these days. TikTok you, Instagram you, message, whatever it is. You've got to reach out. By the way, I have a friend named Sean. He actually called me yesterday while I was driving home from Costco, and he said, hey man, I just saw you the other day and I was wondering how you're doing. How you been? You look kind of down. You okay? And by the way, this guy Sean, he does that. Every once in a while he calls me. You might have done the math on this already. Sean has a zillion friends. A zillion friends. Why? He reaches out and just says things like, hey man, I saw your Chargers got killed yesterday in that big game. Man, that must have hurt. Ha ha. All right, man. Talk to you later. That's it. It's called touch. He reaches out and he touches people all the time. He's got a zillion friends. Number 4, get
in person with people. Now, for your generation, you college students, this is a bigger deal than it was for me when I was your age. Virtual is great.
It serves a purpose,
but nothing can substitute getting physically in the same space as somebody else. Of course,
once this whole COVID thing is over, that'll be easier to do. But it means
you got to go out and meet people.
Go out, have coffee, get together. Here's a pro tip. Sometimes what I used to do in college was I would invite a variety of people to an event. And I would kind of fib a little bit by saying, hey, you know what? A group of us are getting together to go do this thing. A group of us, we're going to get together and watch the presidential debate. And what you do is you invite 7, 8, 10 other people saying, hey, a bunch of us are getting together. And then lo and behold, you get a few people together. And by the way, you don't feel like you have to be the great host or whatever, or hostess of that. Just getting people together, people naturally form groups and they start chatting, and there you are in the middle of it. And then lastly, here's a pro tip I'll wrap up with. In the church, we tell everybody you need to have a Barnabas, you need to have a Paul. Excuse me, I should go backwards. You should have a Paul, a Barnabas, and a Timothy. And what that means is this: a Paul is like your mentor, somebody above you. In your case, if you're a freshman, it would be a senior maybe. Someone that's gone ahead of you that can kind of share their life experiences with you. And if you're a senior, it probably would be like a graduate student or a professor. Somebody ahead of you in life that you can go to and say, I need help with a problem from where I'm at in life, and you've been there. Can you help me? That's a Paul. Barnabas is your buddy. You gotta have friends, people that are just like you in the same place. If you're a freshman, then you have other freshman buddies and you can commiserate about how much you all hate that one history teacher or whatever. And then lastly, and most important, and this is the one most people fail on, is what we call a Timothy. A Timothy is a mentee. That is somebody you mentor. That is somebody who is worse off than you, or you have more life experience than they do. So if you're a junior, you can look back, is there a freshman somewhere that needs my help? So you have somebody who is above you that you look to for help, a buddy that is somebody that you just pal around with. But don't forget that last important one. I guarantee you somewhere in your college, on your campus somewhere, is somebody who is lonely, somebody who needs help, somebody that could use someone like you to come alongside and help out. By the way, small warning on that one, often those people that you go to help, they don't always appreciate it. They don't often become those lifelong friends like I'm talking to you about. But you know what? It's the best thing out of all those other ones for your soul. Sometimes to just serve somebody and even get nothing in return is the best thing for you.
And if you don't believe me, check out social studies and social science on
the well-being of people who serve and
give away and volunteer. It's all there and it's all real.
Anyways, hope you found some of that stuff helpful. Hope you make lots and lots of great lifelong friends in college.